Yeah, I'm gonna take my horse to the old town road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more. I'm gonna take my horse to the old town road.
I feel like we should let him listen.
We're not even gonna get to the.
I'll play it for him after. I just don't want to get it taken down.
Yeah.
Well, welcome to another episode of Around the 412. Obviously, I'm Tyler. I'm pissed off because I had to listen to that. With me, as always, are Smitty and Herb. I haven't listened to that. That was the first time ever hearing that.
I'm not sure if he's going to hate it after the first verse. Or if
we're also part of Pod Hub Network.
Cold opens.
Speak to the Pod Hub Network. Want to welcome the Working Stiffs podcast to the Pod Hub Network. You can find them on Twitter. Please subscribe to them everywhere. And follow us on Spreaker. Like, that's essentially where, like, the content starts from. And it's for whatever. Like, I get that people don't listen to podcasts on there. Like, you're going to listen.
At least follow
Spotify,
it.
Spotify, iTunes, whatever. But please just go follow the network just on Spreaker.
Can you give me a little, the listeners a little gist of what their podcast is?
So
like you gave us, essentially.
Yeah. A little synopsis, if you will. No, it's literally, like, their lives. Like, they definitely bring, like, entertainment to it. It's good. Like, they go back and forth. But it's just, like, about their blue-collar lives. They both work a ton of jobs. So, like, even for them to just record, it's kind of, like, hard. But it's perfect. Like, they do it, like, every other week. That's the only way that they can even find the time to do it. But, like, I would definitely recommend just giving it just a listen once. And then you're going to want to listen to it every week after that.
Kay.
They put one out. But yeah, very good, Danny and Zach. So, I mean, his name's Zach, so come on. Of course, it's a great show. But, yeah, so go give them a listen. So, I guess we can kind of jump right into it. The big talk of today, right, already. I mean, this kind of goes back to yesterday, but I kind of thought it was going to be over. Stupid me, with the whole Antonio Juju thing, thinking it was going to be over. But it wasn't, because Antonio's got to try to get the last word, even though, in the process, make Juju look better.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, Juju already put that out himself. Like, he put that picture up before Juju did.
Oh, yeah.
A screenshot of that.
Yeah.
You know, from doing that and then being teammates. So, Juju wasn't trying to hide the fact that he DM'd Antonio back in 2015. Why would he be? There's nothing to be sorry about there.
Yeah.
You know, it's a young guy at USC looking for help from the most talented receiver in the NFL. But Antonio tries to use that picture to take a shot at Juju. And I don't
it's
get
it. It's
doing
the opposite.
Yeah.
It's proving Juju's point.
Yeah.
That he once looked up to him and now he's just being an ass.
Yeah. And this wasn't, so like I said, that was today. You know, yesterday, he responds to a fan, you know.
Oh,
this
wait, like, start with the first tweet. Before the responding to the fan. Keep your emotions,
keeping the
off,
emotions
off
the internet. Yeah. And so a fan sends him a screenshot of the Steelers announcing that Juju Smith-Schuster was the team MVP.
Yeah.
And now, as a professional athlete, you got to put that to the side. You know, Antonio, how does he even see this? Like, most guys don't even look at anything that's not from a verified account.
Yeah.
So he sees a random person respond to them.
He was on his burner account. That's how he saw it.
He responds to this person by calling Juju out for fumbling against the Saints and would essentially cost them the season, because then at that point they needed the Browns to beat the Ravens. That didn't happen.
Yeah.
So obviously their biggest game of the season. He said he fumbled the postseason away and that people are just too busy building up, I guess, like what Juju is as a persona and not the actual player to realize the reality of it. And then Juju responded, you know, saying that, yeah, he used to look up to this guy, and it's crazy how big his ego's gotten to do this to people that show you love. Juju has done absolutely nothing to him. You know, you hate you hate the organization, you hate Tomlin, Colbert, Ben, whoever it might be. What has Juju done? He said he was supportive of the whole move to Oakland. He was happy that AB got what he wanted.
Yeah.
Obviously, he wanted him on the Steelers. He said that.
Yeah.
But it didn't happen, and Antonio got what he wanted, so Juju was happy about that fact.
Now, before he decided to say that, troll Juju is the best Juju. Before he said any of that, he decided to tweet, keep your emotions off the internet.
And what's funny is Wiz Khalifa tweeted that. Like, Antonio took it from a Wiz Khalifa, like the exact same thing. So Wiz tweeted it like an hour prior to Antonio, and then Antonio tweeted it, and then Juju. So you had three of the exact same tweets within like 2 hours.
Do you think there's actually something wrong with Antonio?
Look at him.
Okay.
I think how can it not be? I don't care if I seem like an asshole. He's a psychopath.
I mean, I just want to ask the question. Yeah. Damn.
He is mentally wrong.
In a
form. I don't care how insensitive I'm being.
Well, when I say wrong, I'm not just talking like mental health and stuff like that. I'm talking like, do you think it all went to his head?
Oh, yeah. It's always been in his head.
Fair enough.
Yeah, the thing is, you know, it's hard not to appreciate where he came from.
Yeah.
But the thing is that that's where Tyler says it went to his, like, it's always been in
Tyler.
His head. I'm telling you that for the
who the
for the for the podcast.
I was like, Sweeney.
Like he said, for like it's always been there.
Oops.
It's always been in his head, and
Ryan Clark said that.
He himself made it seem like, you know, these humble beginnings, he has to be this person. And that's not the truth. I mean, it would be so much easier to get behind a guy that came from those humble beginnings and remained humble. But that's not him. That's not Antonio.
Yeah, no. I tweeted this morning, and it might have been a little harsh, a little too far, but I said that I would be okay if AB would just, like, vanish off the earth. I didn't tell him to die. I just said if he was just gone.
No.
I'd be perfectly okay with that.
And I hope that there is some type of, you know, when it's all said and done for him in his career, he realizes.
Yeah.
You know, I don't see that happening. Nah. Because, but, no, I can't wish injury or
I don't wish him injury.
Yeah, or anything.
I just
happening.
Wish he would, to me, I'm not saying I wish he would, like, die or get hurt or something. I just wish he would just go away completely. Like, if he was just gone. Because I hate seeing his stuff. I hate seeing everything. I don't follow him on anything. I block him on things. I still see him on stuff.
If he just went full Rashard Mendenhall and just dropped off the face of the internet.
Plays tetherball.
Like, I don't want his influence on my life anymore.
Well, don't let him.
Get out.
You know what's wild?
Well,
is he still
I don't let him. It's just annoying to see.
Oh, yeah,
literally,
no.
He still follows me. I don't understand what I have to say or do. Like, my
response. You just got too much clout.
Apparently, all you have to do is tweet a picture of Juju team MVP. You haven't done that yet.
I don't know. I haven't. I mean, I've just, like, my responses to him, though, are, like, one of the, like, top ones that blow up. And for whatever reason, this dude refuses to.
Yeah, no, I can honestly say I hate Antonio Brown.
Okay.
I hate him.
I
can't stand him. And I was going to bring this up in football, but we brought it up now. Is he, like, the most hated former Pittsburgh athlete ever?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And I mean, the thing that he definitely still has going for him is it's so fresh, too.
Yeah.
Like, the time has not passed at all. But he also continues to build on
I know.
On
that's the thing.
On the already there hate. Like, so had the stuff with Juju not happened, you know, we would have, you know, time would have started to mend that. But there's no time going past between his next thing.
Yeah.
You know, so what's the next thing? He's just start taking shots at who? It's going to happen.
Derek Carr.
I mean,
Derek Carr.
And eventually, like, the Steelers, you're seeing a little bit
of
pushback.
Wait for him to take a shot at Ryan Shazier.
Oh, God.
Oh, if he does that, he might actually get killed.
Like, the thing is, there's no reason guys like Anthony Chickalow or Bud Dupree, and I get that they're individuals, they can do what they want, can continue to support Antonio.
Are they still?
Like, I mean, they comment on his stuff all the time with, like, you know, the picture of, like, a gorilla or something.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Yeah, or, like, just a picture of a back, like, the emoji of the backpack. Like, they were fully supportive of the move to Oakland, which Juju was too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, he got what he wanted. But now at this point, this guy is taking shots at a guy that still is on your team.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't allow that. I mean.
So, remember when The Dark Knight was being filmed here?
I wonder where this is going. Yes.
He's just the Joker. He's just acting.
Okay, I was like, where's this? All right.
He's just acting. He went crazy.
Yeah, and I saw somebody tweet, now this isn't happening, but how funny would it be if now that he got the guaranteed money, he's trying to get another trade because that contract would have to be taken on by the new team.
Who could even
trade back to the Steelers? Hey, I got my contract.
Who could trade
Let
for
me trade back.
Yeah,
let me
like,
come
who
back.
Who could even cover that contract?
The Colts?
I mean.
The Jets?
There's teams that could, but why is there a team that would want to?
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
Oakland,
like
just
cut
them.
You can make that work, for sure. I mean, there's ways to work around that and fit that contract in there. But to me, it's not worth it.
I always touch the...
I know, but you're scaring me.
I always touch the speaker.
And that kind of goes back to the conversation that I brought up that I had with, you know, Ryan Tong and Geddes
on the podcast,
also part of the Pod Hub Network, about, you know, at some point you got to take whatever you can get.
Yeah.
And Ryan and Tong didn't seem to be on board with that. They were like, you know, if the deal's not what you want, you can't accept anything less.
Well, why listen to Ryan anyway? He wanted to trade Letang this year.
Really?
You wanted to trade him last year.
I wanted to trade him last year because I think he'd be good. He wanted to trade him this year because he said he's our best defenseman. He can get the most back.
Well, I mean, technically Crosby could get the most back, but
if you're trading,
you're always wrong.
If you're trading, the most back.
Whenever you talk about trading your best player, you're always wrong.
Yeah, I mean, unless it gets to like this situation where he wants out, he's literally using his social media the way that he was. Like, there was no coming back from that. Yeah. Every team knew that there was not a chance you were keeping him on the roster. You can say what you want. You can say that you're not settling for anything less than a first-round pick. At the end of the day, you're taking the best offer you can get. And Oakland even said that Kevin Colbert tried to start with their second-round pick, and that wasn't happening. So the Raiders wanted him, but they knew that they didn't have to give up a premium pick to do it because the Steelers were desperate to get rid of him.
Yeah.
I'm just happy he's gone.
But he's not. That's the issue. He's still in every Steelers fan's head.
He's in Steelers fan's head, but I'm happy he's gone out of the locker room.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
Like, so I told Smitty this morning, on the way here. Oh, we didn't want to bring up Mark Madden.
No, I mean, it was going to get brought up because I was actually about to say that, like, this is actually a very good point. So
Mark Madden had an article saying, and it was actually coming, I don't want to say he was defending Juju, but he was not against Juju in an article. And he's talking about how AB, he said he went heel on Juju, this WrestleMania, you know.
Yeah.
Obviously, I don't know. Yeah. But and that it is good for the Steelers and for Juju that those two aren't friends, that those two aren't close anymore.
Yeah.
And so he like talked about that.
I agree.
A good point that I honestly wouldn't have thought of. If those two remain close, you know, you might have Antonio whispering in Juju's ear when free agency does come around.
Yeah.
Which is what he brought up. He's saying, like, you could get another, not that Juju would be completely like AB, but, like, you could get another AB situation if they're friends. Yeah. And he has that influence.
Yeah. And no, he doesn't.
Thank God.
But, yeah, I mean, to your point, though, as far as, like, he's gone physically, like, and Ryan brought this up, and it was a good point, like, regardless, there's still going to be questions about him this year. The first time that Juju struggles, there's going to be questions about Antonio.
And if Moncrief doesn't do well, then you're going to be like, oh, you're still missing a wide
receiver.
Or
Washington doesn't take a step forward.
Yeah. Or whoever they draft.
Like, there's going to be questions about him and probably Le'Veon, too. I mean,
there shouldn't be questions about Le'Veon after last season. But
right. It goes, like, even if you see people tweeting about, like, well, they lost Le'Veon and Antonio, you know. Well, Le'Veon wasn't part of the team even last year, though, so that should have been,
I'll say they lost Le'Veon
that
after 2017.
That could have been a question last year, but I have no idea why that would be, going forward, a question about Le'Veon not being there.
Yeah.
You know, I was going to say this yesterday, but I didn't know how to word it, but I'll try to word it. Like, even if the Steelers they somehow end up being worse than they were last year, I am at least happy that he's not here.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of tough because the only thing I really care about is winning. Like, I mean, look how long we put up with Antonio when other people weren't willing to or wouldn't have been willing to.
Well, yeah, but he was never like this, though.
Yeah, and now it's just like winning takes precedent over all, so to see them take a step back, it's definitely, I don't know where I stand with that. I'd have to think about it. Like, would I rather have Antonio being the exact person he is right now, but somehow still be a playoff team with him, or be even worse than last? Well, they didn't make the playoffs last year, but be even worse than last year.
Well, I know one thing. I would hate talking about him on our show in the fall.
Yeah.
I couldn't stand it.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think it's just time for the Steelers to kind of, not necessarily rebuild, but
tank for Trevor Lawrence? Yes.
Tank for someone?
Trevor Lawrence? Yes.
Whoever.
No, that's him. That's who we're tanking for.
Well, I mean, with everyone on the team right now, let's say you're going to tank this year. With everyone on the team, you're not going to come within the bottom five.
Yeah, I know. That's why you sit them or cut them. I'm just joking, by the way. They're not going to be able to tank for Trevor Lawrence.
I'm not tanking
until
Ben's officially done.
That's what I'm saying.
There's still I mean, let's see what the Browns do this year. But the Browns haven't proven anything with their roster yet. I mean, this is still like
on paper they're going to the Super Bowl. Apparently,
yeah. This is still a division that the Steelers are going to compete in my opinion.
I still think they're going to win it.
In my opinion, it's up in the air. I'd be willing to put money on the Browns, but probably not even a smart choice.
I wouldn't put money on anybody. If I'm picking, it's going to be the Steelers because I'm biased.
Yeah.
But I'm not willing to put money on that.
Yeah,
I mean, I got to see what the Browns do. I mean, now if the Steelers are, like, bad this season, then I don't know what you do.
Yeah.
I don't, like, a rebuild really is only going to last as long as it takes you to find a quarterback.
Yeah, pretty much.
In my opinion. Well,
for the Steelers, it lasts as long as you need to find a cornerback, but...
Yeah, but like...
So they've been rebuilding like since forever. Their last Super Bowl appearance.
But, I mean, what I said is especially the case for the Steelers because they have other pieces around. I mean, you're going to put a quarterback behind a really good line right away. I mean, when you lose Ben, you're probably losing Pouncey, too.
Yeah.
But I don't know. The continuity is still there with the offensive line. I just feel like... I mean, I can repeat the point. The rebuild will only last as long as it takes them to find their franchise quarterback.
Which, I mean, look at the Browns. They didn't have the skill players or all the other positions that the Steelers have, but they found their quarterback, and the team got better.
Yeah.
That's why, like, for me, the Giants last year, they may have got the best player in the draft, but they drafted the wrong player.
Yeah,
Because what does a great running back do you if you don't have a quarterback? Nothing.
Yeah.
They won five games.
I said that, and I got absolutely torched for it by people on Twitter saying that the Giants should not draft a running back. Well, Saquon Barkley is the best player in the draft. I don't care.
Yeah.
Let another team take the best player in the draft then because you don't need
the
best player
in
the draft.
Yeah.
You need the best player that you can get at the most important position on the field.
Yeah. Same reason why Kyler Murray is going to be drafted number one this year.
Because...
Have they done anything with what's his face yet?
Rosen?
Yeah.
I mean, he's still on the team.
They said there's no trade talks ongoing. And he was actually, him and Kingsbury walked into the Cardinals facility for their offseason workouts. They were the first two to walk in together.
Huh.
I'm still saying Kyler's going number one.
He's not.
I'll put money down on it.
Do it. Go to the casino right now.
Can you bet on those things?
I'm sure.
Oh, yeah.
It's a prop bet or something.
Okay. I will.
I don't know. I'm pretty skeptical on it.
Yeah. I could... Oh, man. Who's the first team up that actually needs a quarterback?
The Cardinals?
Well.
Oakland?
Well. They think they're...
New York?
I'm thinking he goes to Miami.
He's not falling to 13.
You think?
Yeah. No.
I
do not think he would get past four. I think Oakland would draft him.
Yeah. I forgot about that whole situation. Yeah.
I think if he doesn't go at one, he's going at six. I don't think the Raiders would take him at four.
Who's six?
Giants.
I don't know. They're so stupid.
But even so, even if he, like, you still have the decision between him and Haskins, and that's where we disagree.
Yeah.
But... I think he's a better if it's the Cardinals taking a quarterback, then yeah, I'm taking Kyler over Haskins.
Yeah.
If I'm anybody else, I'm taking Haskins.
Yeah, fair enough.
That's where I stand with it. But I don't see – I think that the Giants would also – I heard that they're a little weary on Haskins, so I think the Giants would also go Kyler.
Fair enough.
But who's to even say that the Giants are going to take a quarterback? They keep committing to Eli Manning for another year.
Exactly. That's what was going through my head. By the way, I'm working on like 3 hours of sleep.
Which is another thing, like we talked about, they take Saquon last year as opposed to getting another quarterback in a quarterback class where they're actually like legitimate
good quarterbacks,
first round picks.
Yeah.
Now we're going to see if there's talk that there's four quarterbacks that go in the first round. Kyler, Dwayne Haskins, Drew Locke, Daniel Jones.
I have not heard of two of those people.
Now, the way that I've seen a lot of mock drafts play out is Jones to Miami and Locke to the Redskins at 15. That's the perfect scenario, by the way, for the Steelers, to relate this to the Steelers. If four quarterbacks go before you pick at 20, that's the best case scenario.
Yeah.
Because they're not taking other positions. But anyway, Yeah, the Giants taking a running back last year. I guess that was the whole point of this
conversation yeah.
was stupid, because by the time that you're ready to compete again, hopefully, his contract's gonna be over.
Yeah.
And he's a running back. So what are you gonna be willing to give him?
Emphasis on he's a running back.
No, I mean, you can tag him.
Yeah.
Go the exact same route that the Steelers did with Le'Veon if you want. But
I'm sure it will work.
Yeah.
I think Will Greer is better than Drew Locke and Daniel Jones, too.
Oh, no.
Hmm. Will Greer's...
I can hear the banjo playing in the background coming over the hill. Get it?
Almost heaven.
I think Will Greer's the only guy that's, like, not in the first group of quarterbacks that I would think, like, possibly can be a starter in the league.
Like, to me, I think he should... sit behind a starter, not start right away.
Pulling Aaron Rodgers.
Basically, yeah, basically do it Aaron Rodgers.
I feel like mentality-wise, he's got like the same thing going on as Baker.
Oh, he said he thinks he's the best quarterback.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of guys say that. Watching him play, he just looks like he has the same like demeanor
yeah.
and stuff like that. I mean, yeah, I'm sure that, I don't even know, Kenny Pickett probably thinks he's the best quarterback in college football too, but.
8 yards.
8 yards.
Kind of brought up Ryan Shazier because of a,
yeah.
let's see if Antonio Brown goes that far, but yeah. he is making progress. Anybody didn't see the video of him doing box
jumps.
You would
call that progress? I can't
that's,
do that.
That's more yeah. athletic than I've done in
that 8 years. Was hard, dude.
Yeah.
That's 6 years? More athletic than I have done in
I've at
years.
No point in my life been told grammar. I might not walk again, and I still have never been able to accomplish that, so.
You do have polio, though.
That's true. But I've never been diagnosed with anything where they said you're not going to be able to walk anymore.
Yeah, true.
But yeah, that's insane. And I saw people, like, not necessarily saying this bodes better or worse for a comeback. I mean, it all comes down to is he going to be able to get medical clearance when time comes. But I saw somebody saying, like, this is obviously another step closer to that. And no one's going to be the one to tell him that he's not going to.
No. Like,
if he believes that he's going to play, whatever. Like, I mean.
The fact that he's even doing that is insane.
Yeah. Until he officially says he's not playing football again, I'll believe in him.
Yeah. Pretty much.
That's where I stand with
him. When is his, like, technical contract up?
I mean, they had to re-sign him this year.
Yeah.
As a player.
Did they?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
So, yeah, because, I mean, he came in 14. So, yeah, 14, 15, 16, 17, fifth-year option would have been 18. Yeah.
But they made all that signing bonus.
Yeah.
And they made all this year's signing bonus, too.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it just goes back to, like, at the end of the day, yeah, they don't, like, guarantee all the dollars up front that you wish that they would as a player, but they're going to take care of you.
Yeah, exactly.
If you aren't a self-righteous dick.
speaking of getting taken care of.
That sounds like some, like... Sunday school BS that they tell you when you're
self-righteous is not righteous. that's a very different definitions.
I'm just joking.
Self-righteous is AB.
Listen, oof. I didn't go to Sunday school, so.
You want to go?
No.
All right. Speaking of getting taken care of.
Do you ask him if he wants to go?
DeMarcus Lawrence got a 5-year, $105 million deal with the Cowboys. I'm curious as to what this means for Dak, Zeke, Amari.
Yeah.
How can they take care of all these guys like that? I mean, they all want
Jerry Jones. Just
they all want paid.
Hundreds. Yeah.
I mean, I don't see how you can give those four all what they want, plus be able to build a actual good football team around that.
You can't. But Jerry Jones is stupid.
Does Dak have to be signed after next year?
I think so.
Or
yeah, I mean, he doesn't have. Zeke has the ability to put a fifth-year option on. Dak doesn't,
So last year under contract?
When was he drafted?
Wasn't this his third year in the league? I think.
Yeah. I guess so.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, so yeah, wow, that's crazy.
After this season, he's up.
Man, does time go fast. Yeah.
Let's get real deep.
But anyway, yeah, so, I mean, they can put the option on Zeke, that's the only one that they actually have some control over that isn't a lot. Yeah, I saw that.
That's too good.
That isn't a long-term deal. With Amari, they got to do that. He's a free agent after this year. And then they got to take care of Dak as well. And then it might be worse giving Zeke the franchise.
Oh, yeah. All I'm going to say is that Jerry Jones is stupid enough to pay all of them.
I mean, why even take care of Dak? Just get rid of him and get a real quarterback.
Yeah. They're going to be mediocre for eternity as long as Jerry Jones owns them.
I don't know. Because it's like, it's hard because it's not that Dak's necessarily like irreplaceable, but he's good enough to win with.
Yeah.
And like, it might be kind of hard to find, like, to say, we've gone to the playoffs with this guy. We've won a couple playoff games with him.
Yeah.
Now we're going to get rid of him and try to find another quarterback to do that just because we can't afford to pay him. Because quarterback is the most important position. I mean, we literally just said that. So yeah. How do you justify getting rid of a guy that you've seen actually win your team games to pay a running back and a guy catching balls from that quarterback? I mean, out of the three, he's the worst at his position out of the three.
Oh, yeah.
But he plays the most important position. So it's kind of it's a fine line. I'm curious to see how they do it.
I don't have faith the Cowboys make any right decisions, so.
Yeah. But you got to think, I mean, they're still, you look at the Redskins, they, I don't know what they're doing. They're like basically 500 somehow for like the decade. Like they're the most mediocre team, but they don't have a quarterback right now. The Giants, we know that they're not going to be good next year.
Yeah.
They really shouldn't be trying to be good.
But they are.
You have the Eagles, who looked like they were going to miss the playoffs last year, and then all of a sudden turned it on. Actually end up winning the playoff game and almost won two. Almost got back to the NFC Championship. And then you have them. I mean, I still think that the Cowboys can compete in that division.
Oh, yeah.
And go back to the playoffs. But, yeah, a lot of things for them to figure out after the season.
Do you think somebody, the winner of that division, is going to be under 500? Do you think there's the potential, is what I should say?
Potential, no, maybe, I think the Eagles will be above 500.
I think the Cowboys and Eagles will get the wins in their own division.
Yeah.
And I don't know what outside, but I would think that the winner of that division probably wins 9 or 10 games.
Fair enough.
Steelers have signed 3 players.
Are they from the AAF?
I have no idea.
Probably.
It just says cornerback Cameron Kelly.
Yeah, he was.
Linebacker JT Jones and defensive tackle Winston Craig.
Don't know.
Yeah, whatever.
The first one definitely was from the AAF.
They probably were too.
The Browns signed Morgan Burnett.
Yeah.
A few days ago.
Omega Wall.
So I dropped them a win.
Did you laugh like that lizard?
Yes.
You dropped them a win?
Yeah, so.
He docked them for making a sign.
I went over Ross's on Saturday, and there was a kid there that we know who's a Browns fan, and we were like talking about the Browns, and we were all saying how many games we think they're going to win. And I said, right now I'll put them at like 10-6. And then later in the night, we were talking. We were like, oh, yeah, Morgan Burnett signed with the Browns. I was like, that's right, 9-7. But, like, I mean, they'll probably put him in a more natural role for him. He wasn't happy about being, like, a dime backer here. He wants to just be a safety. But the thing that's weird about that is, like, his role with the Packers was kind of a hybrid. And now he doesn't want to play hybrid. I don't know. I don't get it. But he sucked here. And I have a feeling that he's not going to last very long in Cleveland. Like, they traded Ogba for Eric Murray, and yeah. I feel like Eric Murray could end up being the starter there over Burnett.
Probably.
Pretty early in the season.
By the way, I just want to say this. We're not on baseball.
We're about to make the switch.
The Trump administration has just made their argument of being a good administration even worse because they just fucked everyone in Cuba.
Wait, what?
What does this have to do with baseball?
Hold on. Hold on. Stop laughing. Trump administration nixes MLB's deal with Cuba that would have allowed players from Island Nation to sign with big league teams without defecting.
Okay.
So we're back to the guys are going to have to be potentially thrown in jail forever just to play baseball.
Okay. Glad you made the connection.
Yeah. I was like, wait a minute. Where's this going?
Well, wasn't that the whole thing with like Puig and all them?
Yeah. Yeah, right.
Exactly. That's dumb. I don't know why you would be against that.
Puig should be thrown in jail forever anyway.
Well. Oh, yeah. Wait.
What?
Why?
Because he's Puig.
All right, we're gonna talk about baseball now anyway. All right, so
try to attack a whole team.
The first thing I wanted to start off talking about was the starting pitching of the Pirates. How good it's been.
Until today.
Well, hey, Thailand didn't give up an earned run somehow. Yeah. Zero.
Kevin Newman
runs.
Ass.
Right. So the only point that I was trying to make on Twitter, I got absolutely roasted for this, was yes, that's Newman's fault that the inning continued.
Oh, yeah.
At the time of that first error, though,
mm-hmm.
there's still zero on the board.
Yeah.
You have two outs, and John Lester's hitting.
Agreed.
Taillon's got to get him out. Like, so yeah. That also falls on his shoulders.
Now, I wasn't watching the game because I was at work. How bad was that last pitch to Lester?
It was an 0-2, and he put through in the strikes. I have no idea why he's throwing the ball anywhere near the strike zone.
Yeah. So that, but that also brings into my whole theory, Little League mentality.
Of just throwing strikes.
No, something goes wrong, shell, just turtle.
Oh.
Just,
That's what I mean. Like, you got to have some mental toughness there to pick up your guy and pitch.
Yeah.
Make pitches, just get out of the inning with a zero still on the board, and then their top of the lineup's obviously coming up
Little
now.
Little League mentality.
And as the inning went on, Kevin Newman got worse. And the Cubs proceeded to be the luckiest team to ever exist.
This is
I wonder what their PDO was.
This is why I still said that I'd give them a chance in the division because they're luck.
I want to burn that stadium from the
John Lester.
Up.
John Lester.
Ground.
John Lester pitching at Wrigley gets 4 inches on each side of the plate.
Yeah.
Leeway.
Manny Gonzalez.
Javi Baez doesn't actually have to hold his bat to get
no,
a hit.
That. So. Manny
Rizzo smashing one off Taillon's head into center field.
So they said on the broadcast, it just kind of
that happened today. You're talking about when that happened before.
No, it happened again.
Yeah. It happened again?
It was 104 off the bat, I think.
That was somebody who – that wasn't Rizzo that hit him.
No, but I remember Taillon got hit.
Yeah. That was back in 16.
Now
it was
said
in the back of the head.
So they said on the broadcast it just glanced him.
Yeah, I think – I mean, it looked like he kind of got his glove up. Yeah. So, yeah, I don't know if it, like, deflected the glove then his hat.
Because, yeah.
I mean, he was like – don't send anybody out here. I'm fine.
Like, yeah, they said it just kind of like nicked his hat, and that was it. But yeah, Manny Gonzalez's crew is the worst crew in the MLB. Mark my words.
What about the ump in that Astros game?
Oh,
the one that like...
Was that Jerry Lane?
That did... I don't know if that was his crew.
I think that was Jerry Lane.
No.
It wasn't? Okay. Mm-mm. I can't remember who it was. Yeah, he's just
who did he shove with his mask?
That's a good question. I didn't watch it that
whoever
far.
The Astros catcher is, Max Stassi or Stacy, however you pronounce it.
Yeah.
So he said, I can do whatever I want. And so people were, and people were making me.
Like, Garrett Cole was putting the ball right down the middle, and he was like, not calling it a strike.
So
people were making memes about that, putting his head on Thanos, saying reality can be whatever I want it to be.
They're not wrong. They're not wrong. At what point? Is this season just going to be the season where everybody goes, okay, maybe we should have computers?
It's going to be the season where there's fist fights between umpires and
oh, teams. Absolutely. Absolutely. It's going to be amazing. We're going to have to pay pay-per-view money to the CDs.
Pay-per-view for MLB baseball.
I'm trying to find out the name of this guy.
We're, what, 2 weeks into the season, and it's already infuriating how bad the umps have been.
Yeah.
They've been absolutely
like
horrible.
Who was the crew in the first series? Joe West?
Yes.
Yeah.
That
wasn't good.
Ron Culpa.
Ah, that's who it was. Yes, he's a douche. He's notoriously a douche.
He's a douche.
Yeah. Mr. West over there, I don't know how he still has a job. He's been consistently bad his entire career.
And it's like...
And everyone loves him.
But it's so easy to point out how bad he is. It's
I know.
Like... And it's consistent, like you said. And it's been not just, you know, with old age as he's getting up there.
No, it's just, like, he's ass.
Yeah.
And, like, there's a difference between missing a call by that much and making a call by that much.
Yeah.
It's been unbelievably consistent and more apparent this year. Whether it be in the strike zone, on the
field.
Like
you said, at least he's consistent.
Well, it's not proper consistent. But I get the sports human error. It's just, at this point, it's very dumb. It's ruining.
Yeah, I mean, there's human error, but the problem is that there's umpires that it happens once in a blue moon.
Yeah.
And then there's umpires like Joe West where it's like a Kevin Newman inning.
Exactly. If it happens once and you admit that you were wrong, whatever. But there's guys like Ron Culpa that are doing it the entire game, and then when somebody calls them out on their bullshit, he loses their mind and challenges them to fight.
Yeah. I mean, that was literally like, yeah, that could have escalated to the point where there was actually a fight.
It should
have
been.
Because of the umpire.
Yeah.
The guy who's supposed to enforce the game. Like,
oh. Manfred might actually ruin the game for me.
Oh, hey. Speaking of fights, yeah. There's yesterday's.
Should we talk about that?
Yeah, I mean, tussle. That's the last thing to talk about. Tussie. So,
but we haven't talked about baseball too much.
Shame.
In general.
Yeah, I know.
So,
I mean,
the starting pitching has been good.
Yeah.
For
how about
part.
Melky Cabrera?
Melky. See,
Lonnie Chisenhall is shaking.
So, for the past 2 years, I've said Melky Cabrera should be on the Pirates, and they finally do it, and it's finally paying off.
Yeah, I mean,
I'm so mad.
You still
watching
you
him it, run is
you
painful.
Give it, you give and take.
Yeah,
you give and take.
I mean,
like he's like stiff like a board whenever he runs.
He's like Colin Moran.
It's so upright
years.
And he looks just tight, but somehow he gets to the ball in the outfield.
Who I can't remember. What
I can't
sport
imagine
it was.
Him stealing a base in his life.
I can't remember what sport it was. There was some old dude that was like, ah, screw your stretching. You got to feel the tightness to run.
Yeah, that's him.
Yeah.
That's Melky.
Like, he just hits. That's what he is. Like, they said he's a professional hitter. That's literally what he brings to the table.
Yeah. And he every once in a while, he does make a good play in the field.
Yeah. Now, the thing is, he makes plays that are probably more routine for other guys.
Make it worse.
Yeah. Not look that great, yeah. But he gets it done.
Yeah.
But it begs the question, DiNardo and I were kind of talking about this. Does this mean it's kind of like when Chisenhall comes back, what do?
Good question.
Because the way I saw it when Melky was signed was not necessarily Melky was on the team till Polanco comes back and then you DFA him or
yeah,
whatever.
Exactly.
I didn't see it like that. My thought was he's on the team for sure until Polanco gets back and then you make the decision between him, Chisenhall,
and
whoever
Reyes.
Else. I mean, but I'm just thinking, like, specifically, can you put Chisenhall somewhere else in the infield?
Yes.
I don't know.
Yes.
We'll see. He's played third and a little bit of first in his career. Mm.
Could he do worse than Newman is short today?
I saw somebody saying, like, second base. He has 0 career innings at second base. But
In my opinion, if you can play third, you can play second.
But we'll see. It's just weird. Honestly, it's weird. It was weird to me that he hadn't. That's why I was looking it up.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. We'll see if they get creative to keep both of them on the roster.
Yeah.
But
in my opinion, they should.
Yeah.
Both of those off the bench is much better than Pablo Reyes and Kevin Newman.
Yeah, I mean, personally, I'm waiting for Kevin Kramer over Kevin Newman, but
really, still,
yeah,
I've kind of given up on both of them. I don't think I was high on either of them in the first place. It was just kind of like bring in new faces because that's all we have to look forward to. Now it's just kind of like okay, give me Cole Tucker and O'Neill Cruz.
Well, see, I'm still skeptical about O'Neill Cruz at short. Otherwise, I guess I'd be saying the same thing. Or in the infield in general.
You could put him anywhere, in my opinion.
I mean, we'll see. I hope he proves me wrong, but I don't know.
Don't talk bad about somebody with our shirt.
As far as Kramer,
he literally
goes,
said, Pablo has been ass. So far, did you tweet that?
Yeah.
Well, he's been right in that statement.
What I actually saw his wife on Twitter is like has responded to everybody that's like actually said his name, like Pablo Reyes, just with like laughing faces because people are like demote him, all these other things.
No.
Yeah. So we got one of those things going on right now. But anyway, I like Kevin Kramer's pop for sure, at a position where you don't typically get it at second base if that's where he's going to play. For us, I mean, we'd probably be asking him to play short right now.
Do you think Kramer ends up as a Max Moroff?
No.
Traded to the Indians?
Not here. possibly. No, I think he's a more consistent hitter. Like,
fair enough.
Think he'll hit for a higher clip than Moroff did.
Yeah,
I think
Moroff, anytime
I think
he got a hit,
base.
It was a home run. And
time
he got
like,
a home run, it went into the river.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that he also will reach base at a higher percentage due to walks. I don't think Moroff was a very patient hitter.
No.
I mean, defensively, Moroff was actually okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, he had a pretty good glove, but we'll see. I like Kevin Kramer more than Kevin Newman.
Yeah.
But
defensively, Eric Gonzalez has been really up and really down at times.
Yeah, I mean, he's made a couple plays that you're like, oh, that might be on SportsCenter top 10. And then...
He's made a couple plays where they're like, oh, that might be on SportsCenter not top 10.
Right. <Yeah. laughs> That's what
he's had some
like,
very good at-bats. He's had some really bad at-bats. He's had a very couple good hits. He's had some very bad base running mistakes.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't doubt that he's good defensively. He just needs to be more consistent with it.
Yeah.
Because he... It's frustrating to watch.
You just need to be better.
And that's honestly all that, personally, I'm asking is for the defense. I mean, whatever we get with the bat's a plus. Because other than, you know, his, what, two of his first three trips to the plate were with a guy on third with zero or one out. Neither time he got him in. I mean, that's a – I guess that's not – it's not as easy to do as I'm making it sound.
Oh, yeah.
To get that guy in, to just put a ball in the air. But – Come on, man. Like,
yeah. It's frustrating.
But, yeah, if he's even just a little bit below average at the plate but gives you the defense that I feel like he's capable of, then I'll take it because alternative isn't there.
He's still much better than the alternative in Jordy Mercer. So
yeah. Oh, well, I thought you were going to say Kevin Newman.
Yeah.
But,
well, that too. That too.
But, see, that's the thing. Is like, what does it say about Kevin Newman that Gonzalez beat him out for the starting job?
A lot.
Like, that, to me, shows where the Pirates are at with him.
Yeah.
And I didn't know about the whole thing with him, like, getting worn down from playing every day, and he lost, like, 15 pounds in the minors, Kevin Newman. They were talking about that after he hit the walk-off, was, you know, this is a guy with talent. He kind of lost it mentally and physically when he played. I can't remember how many games he played. Might have been, like, not 155. Close to a full, like, every game, every game at short, and just wore him down. He ended up losing, like, 15 pounds that season. So, but, I mean, I don't know.
Yeah,
the defense, to me, we all knew coming into the season was going to be the weak point of this team.
Yeah.
And they haven't done anything to make us believe any different to this point.
Yeah, pretty much.
To be honest with you, Josh Bell hasn't looked that bad at first defensively.
No.
But he just looks like a regular first base. Like, he makes a regular pick that a first baseman does, and we're like, oh, my God. Because it's him. Like,
and we've had all the people we've had in the past.
Yeah.
And at least his bat picked up
the past couple games. That home run was majestic.
Yeah. I mean, you just hope that it's not just a little. I mean,
according to Mike, he was the worst everyday player in baseball.
I love that he tweeted that. Thank God.
That's bold.
But he's not going to continue at this pace by any means, but there's somewhere in the middle, and that's what he needs to be. He can't be as bad as he had been, and he's not going to be that great. I mean, I don't think.
No.
I mean, if he's getting 5 extra base hits every 4 games, then.
I mean, still theoretically, he's on pace for 100 plus RBIs.
And that's what you want from him. Like, RBIs are a whatever stat, but you ultimately, from
it
your
still
number
matters.
Four guy, need a guy to bring in runs.
Yeah,
like,
exactly. As much as I say I'd much rather have a team that can just consistently hit instead of one guy that can hit home runs but strikes out 9 out of 10 times.
Yeah. But we're talking
about.
You
still need somebody to bring everybody home.
Yeah, and you're looking at the team that you actually have. I mean, if we had a guy that everybody got on base, then that's fine.
Yeah.
Just. It would be just a machine. Everybody just hits after one another.
Yeah.
We don't have that. We need to put guys in the middle of the lineup that are going to bring those guys in for when we do have runners on base at the top.
The bottom of the lineup's a black hole right now.
And that's, I mean, when you have, like, Kevin Newman was the sixth hitter.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, when that's your sixth hitter, your lineup's over before it gets to that.
Yeah. Also, I do want to say this, even though I just said it's a black hole for the bottom of the lineup. Didn't Ron Cook say 7, 8, and 9 didn't look like murderer's row, and we're just kind of like, it's 7, 8, and 9.
9? I want to bring up as a pitcher.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, exactly.
There's that.
Meanwhile,
what do you guys
think
about hitting the pitcher 8th?
I've been a proponent of that. I've been a proponent of that since I was like 12.
Because I mean, the Cubs do it pretty regularly.
Yeah,
they did almost the entire season.
Yeah,
I think 2 years ago.
Like, what's the benefit and what's the disadvantage?
I mean, the benefit is that you feel like you're turning your lineup over at the 9 spot as opposed to the 1. So then your leadoff hitter is like. Actually potentially hitting with a guy on base.
Mm.
Yeah.
I mean, I wouldn't mind it.
But will Clint Hurdle do it? No.
Who's our 8? Who's our 8 hitter?
Gonzalez.
I mean, he's basically a pitcher, so.
Well.
Right. You would probably want to actually put, like, it really only works if you have another good, like, hitter there. You know what I'm saying? Like, if we had our full complement of players, with, I mean, now I'm talking about roster, like lineup construction on the fly here. Frazier's placed second, has been hitting first. Marte.
Dickerson.
Yeah, if we're healthy. Well, where's Polanco going to hit when healthy? Five. Okay, so Dickerson, Bell, Polanco.
Gunn. Slash Moran.
Gunn or Moran.
Cervelli.
Wow, yeah. Cervelli might work there, to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. Because they've actually used him as, like, a leadoff hitter. So your highest on-base percentage guy.
When this team is healthy, I wouldn't mind the lineup I would want.
Yeah.
Because that lineup, to me, if they're clicking, which they never have in the past at the same time as everything else, you can just cycle through that constantly.
Marte's actually been off to a pretty slow start. That's one thing I wanted to talk about. Like, yeah. But he did drive in those two big runs on the double.
He did.
Yeah. But overall, looking at it, he's been pretty frustrating to start the season.
Oh, yeah.
But he's going to average out to what he is as a player. He's not going to be any better, any worse than he typically is. These people that are expecting like a 30-30 season from him, I don't know where you're getting that.
Yeah.
It's never happened. We've never had any suggestion that was going to happen.
30 homers?
Yeah.
We took him off roids. It's not happening. Like,
yeah, he's a 20 home run guy. That's what he
is.
If
that.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he's a guy that steals a ton of bases, too.
Yeah.
I mean, he might be a 20-30, not a 30-30.
No. No. So.
Maybe a 15-30.
Now that the complaining is passed, can we talk about the fun situation that happened on a Sunday afternoon?
Is that anything I want to talk about? Yeah, I guess so. I mean, well,
fun situation?
Rich Rod looks like he's coming back to.
Huh. Don't jinx it.
Thank God.
Don't jinx it.
Well, pretty much the whole bullpen, for the most part, after that Cardinal series, during the Red series, they looked great.
Yeah.
Yeah. We lost Crick for right now.
The Cardinal series, that was the most frustrating two-game series. Losing in the same fashion both games you were winning.
They could have very well only lost one game opening week.
Yeah. They could be, what, 7-1?
Yeah.
It's
7-2 now.
Well, yeah. Game's not over, but yeah.
I think they could very well be undefeated before today.
Yeah. They could.
Yeah.
They very well could.
No, opening day and then Buck night were so frustrating, and I was at both.
Mm-hmm. Don't go again.
Don't plan on it.
Okay, yeah. So yeah.
Sunday afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
So another guy that I said the Pirates should sign, Derek Dietrich. Killed a ball.
Yeah.
And proceeded to not move.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't have an issue with that at all. It is kind of funny that he was DFA'd less than 6 months ago and probably shouldn't be doing that anyway.
Lols.
But good for him. He also didn't hit a home run in a week and your team is 1-6. Proceeds to take 27 seconds around the base. Next time he comes up, Arch tries to hit him in the ass.
Yeah.
And David Bell loses his mind.
Right.
And then Yasiel Puig goes, Yasiel Puig.
Now, the question is, was Archer ever actually going to – I don't think he was ever playing – like, I think he actually did what he wanted to do.
Oh, yeah, miss
was
him.
Just,
yeah, throw
yeah,
behind him. Yeah.
Not hit him, was throw behind him.
I agree.
To me, Dietrich – I mean, you can showboat. Like, I don't mind it.
Yeah.
I don't mind showing emotion. Archer does it from the mound. Mm-hmm. Cervelli's a pretty emotional guy behind the plate.
As you could tell when he hit the home run.
They went back and actually showed – when Archer struck out Dietrich like 3 times in a game and said that probably played into it.
Oh,
yeah. Dietrich's response there.
Absolutely.
There's a little bit of a difference to me, though, between showing emotion in a bat flip as opposed to literally just standing there for a while.
Yeah.
That, I mean, whatever. It still is what it is. Archer shouldn't be throwing at him.
No.
And the biggest reason that, like, I wouldn't have an issue with it if it wasn't putting other guys at risk.
Yeah.
Because then you worry about, are the Reds going to throw at one of our guys? Now, both teams were warned, so you're risking obviously being thrown out if you
and
have somebody do wasting that.
Wasting a roster spot, yeah.
But who's to say it's not going to happen the next game that
yeah.
they play each other? You know, I'm not just talking about this game. So that's the only reason that I don't like it, is because you're putting other people at danger. If Archer himself were just going to have to wear one, then so be it. You put yourself in that spot.
Yeah.
But I feel like he was putting a teammate at risk by doing that.
So I think it was – I don't know who said it, actually. They said – well, I don't like that because, oh, it was Mitch, because Marte's going to take one in the hand next at bat. And I'm like, if you're intentionally going to hit someone, you're not hitting them in the hand.
That yeah, pinpoint accuracy to do that.
Yeah, if you do that, you're a dick.
Yeah. I'd say for two reasons. One, wow.
Yeah.
If you're doing that, like, I mean, whatever.
Wow.
But also, too, yeah, you're taking away a guy for, you're probably breaking his hand. Or yeah. taking your chance at doing so.
Yeah.
So you're taking a guy away from his team and out of his sport for a while. I mean, that's just, yeah.
Yeah, you're a dick. But yeah, it, so I don't really care that he threw behind him. Like, he can feel how he wants to feel.
Yeah.
I don't care. The fact that Yasiel Puig decided, hey, now's a good time to lose my mind after the first scrum already died down is kind of dumb.
Yeah, what I say. Prison for life.
That's not prison for life. That's just kind of like a dude.
Prison for life.
You got to wonder what was going on there.
Oh, well.
Like, was something else had to be...
I was going
to
say, you don't know what's being said.
Yeah.
And I know Melky was trying to talk him down, and then Tucker Barnhart absolutely failed at his job of being an offensive lineman.
Yeah.
Tom Prince. With the guns.
I would say, Barnhart failed at being an offensive lineman because Tom Prince was an incredible linebacker.
Yeah.
But I don't know, like, you see these things happen every year.
I'm just excited it happened early in the year so we can see it unfold the rest of the year.
Yeah. They still play each other for how many more series?
At least 13 more games. Mm. 14 since the one rained out.
Right. Yeah. But, yeah, I don't, once again, I don't have guys, like, Archer pitches with emotion. I like it. Guys bat flip. It's fun to see. There was a little bit more there than just a bat flip from Dietrich. And also, you don't know if, you know, maybe there was obviously more history there, apparently. And you don't know if he said anything to Cervelli or something when he got to home plate, because it looked like Cervelli said something to him.
Oh, he absolutely did.
So, I mean, I saw it coming the whole time. I don't love throwing at the guy just because, like I said, it's putting another guy at risk.
Yeah.
After that. So I guess we'll just have to wait and see if somebody else has to wear one now and next time they play.
Probably.
You would think that the lead in the umpires of that game have this in the back of their head and tell them before even the game starts, listen, the first guy to hit somebody or throw at somebody, they're gone.
Yeah, exactly. The other funny part about that, Amir Garrett.
Yeah.
What'd he say?
They're lucky
that they didn't, like, we didn't, like, start throwing punches.
Oh,
because it wouldn't have ended up good for them.
A guy that didn't throw a single punch and just kind of stood there said, oh, it's good we didn't throw punches because
and
they would
actually,
have
he actually, he got tossed, didn't he?
He's right, yeah. Because Esrod isn't on our team anymore.
realistically, with Puig and Amir Garrett's a pretty big dude.
He is.
Yeah. So,
but he's also a horrible pitcher.
Who's matching up with them for the Pirates? I mean,
Josh Bell.
Vasquez is going to kill both of them.
Big Joe.
Vasquez Bell. Has seen some shit.
Yeah, his sister.
Stop. In that picture, he's just completely straight-faced.
Yeah.
He's gone through some stuff.
Rich, like... That's
he had like a nom flashback in that.
I put that picture up, like, Trevor's pissed. Felipe's unfazed.
Yeah.
And then Rich Rod just standing there, like, with his mouth open.
Yeah.
So the contrast there with those three alone was pretty insane, but yeah, like I said, it's stuff that happens every year in baseball. This won't be the only time that there's a benches clearing brawl in the sport. So
how funny would it be if that was like the only one this year?
Well, we can look back on this and say how wrong we were.
Yeah.
So with this happening with us, it kind of came at a good time to, with Paul Zeiss's take on it. He doesn't mind. Well, he said he doesn't mind people who show emotion, like bat flips and like Archer dancing on the mound and stuff like that. But he's perfectly okay if someone drills him for it too.
Mm.
And
I feel kind of the same way.
Like he's saying it doesn't have to be an either or. Like you either, like you can't, you can like celebrate and then like no one can, like you have no consequence.
Yeah.
But I just want, like, what do you guys think of that?
I'm not about hitting guys in retaliation. I mean, if you're gonna,
but like if someone like pimps a homer off of you, like he's, I mean, I'm not necessarily about hitting them either, but I'm not, if a pitcher wants to hit you for it, I don't really have a problem with it.
Especially,
I mean, my response as the pitcher would be strike him out or just get him out and then show motion back the exact same thing.
Well, yeah, in an ideal world, yeah, but if a pitcher hits, like if a pitcher wants to throw at someone, I don't
necessarily. That's thinking with logic and reason. What you don't do as an athlete is think with logic and reason.
Right.
So.
Yeah. But that's what I mean. So he's asking me, as somebody that's not playing the game, how I feel about it.
Yeah.
And with that being said, I'm thinking with logic and reason
yeah.
as a fan, thinking I don't want somebody getting hit.
Yeah.
In the name of emotion. I understand that emotions are running high during sports.
Hold on. We're already the Jonas Brothers. Can we make that a song? In the name of emotion.
I didn't necessarily mean your take on it. I mean his. Like, what do you think of his?
Yeah,
like,
do you think
it's wrong that someone would wear one if they did that?
Yeah, I don't like hitting guys to begin with, so.
Okay.
I don't disagree or agree with it. Not like,
I don't like hitting guys either. I understand his point of it.
Yeah, exactly.
His point goes along with what's actually going through a pitcher's mind, probably. So.
Yeah, like with Bryce Harper, whenever he did his bat flip that happened, like if someone threw
it
at him.
That's ridiculous how that bat spun.
Oh, I know. It was great. That was amazing. And for everyone listening, I'm all for bat flips and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And I love Chris Archer's dancing. But I understand the other side of it where people get mad at that.
I will swear by it. The worst thing the MLB could have done was end the roid era. All of the roid rage made the sport so big.
I thought you were just saying because of, like, home runs. And
well, that too.
As he loses.
Now they're just roiding out balls instead of.
I pushed it to fall because I was already mad that it dropped.
So my whole point is, back then, people were, like, interested in baseball. Like, they loved the home runs. They loved the emotion. They loved the roid rage. They loved the fights. And it's just kind of like the way America is. Like, they love the fact that everyone hates each other. And the worst thing they could have done
America.
Was... Yeah. The worst thing they could have done was end that. Because their sport, whether they want to admit it or not, is declining across the country.
Just keep juicing the baseballs.
I don't think it's going to work either.
I'm about it.
Ugh.
I wish there was an easier way to, like, kind of like how the issue is in hockey, like hitting people in the head or something. Like, if you hit someone as a pitcher, it's like discretionary because, like, what did you mean to hit them or not? But, like,
yeah.
If you hit someone as a pitcher, I think you should automatically be kicked out and, like, looked at for suspended.
Like, oh, well, yeah.
And that's what I would want.
Yeah.
I agree with that.
Well, I mean, look at Frazier got hit yesterday on the foot by
with
like
a
sweet.
Ball.
Yeah. I would say by like a curveball
mm-hmm.
That just had way too much break.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And people were like, was that on purpose? I'm like, no.
No.
those people are stupid.
Like, most of the time, you can tell whether someone's trying to hit you or not.
Yeah. You could see it when they throw the ball. If the ball is coming out as a fastball or a two seamer and it's directed at you, it's intentional. If you go back and watch the video and it's not a slider that didn't break or a curveball that broke too much, it's intentional.
Yeah, like I don't want hitting in the game, like hitting people.
And
that's
what I mean. It's the same thing to me with the NHL. If you want it completely removed, it doesn't matter if it's intentional or not. Make it to where if it happens, you're getting reprimanded for it.
The baseball one, I think that would be
harder
to do.
Yeah, it's harder.
Because hockey... I agree. You hit someone in the head, intention or not, you're kicked out.
Yeah.
Baseball, like, if you hit them with a pitch, that's a lot less egregious than a head hit in hockey. And, I mean, yeah, it's harder to tell intent, too.
There are certain places that you can kind of tell if it was intentional or not. You know? Like, if you hit them in the ass, the back, or the head... Or the shoulder.
The head.
That's intentional. If you hit him in the foot, the hands, or, like, the lower leg, because generally speaking, you're not going to throw a fastball at the lower leg, that in my opinion, it's not intentional.
I don't know. They're going to break Marte's hand.
Yeah. But that, like you said, in your opinion, it'd be kind of hard, like, as an ump to say, I mean, he hit him in an area where that's probably...
Robots.
But what the... A robot's going to be able to tell that?
I mean, they're always going to have one official up on the booth.
That's the thing. It's all about intent.
Yeah.
And you can't tell intent for the most part.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Unless there was already something that happened that caused that. And if that's, I mean, I don't know. This is a very drawn out topic, I guess. Like, there's a lot of parts to it.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
But, I don't know. End
it's
of the
not
day,
like
I just don't want to see anybody getting hit in baseball. So.
Yeah, and it's not like I have the answer. I'm just saying... Putting it out there and seeing what people think, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, back to Sunday. I don't think Archer... Yeah, I think you're right. Archer didn't want to hit him.
Oh. You used to make the point.
Yeah.
Remember when you used to bitch at me for that?
Yeah, because you did it literally all the time.
I know. Yeah.
But I don't think Archer wanted to hit him, but I kind of felt like he had to do that.
Yeah. I could see it.
Like, I think he felt like he needed to.
If I said
and then
I,
he ended up striking him out anyway.
I
like,
know, yeah.
Yeah.
I also love how they paused the game until
and then he hit another
bench.
One. Not
so,
off Archer, but.
Yeah, so Dietrich ended up in that game hitting two home runs and striking out twice.
He did what he was supposed to do.
Kind of sums up his career.
That's what Ryan said, by the way.
What?
I'm assuming he's talking about Archer throwing at Dietrich.
Oh.
And Archer, well, Archer said he didn't even mean to throw at Dietrich, so.
Well.
Also, well, whenever he was asked the question, he smiled.
Yeah. Also, how about the pine tar thing?
I didn't even see this.
He had, it looked like he had pine tar on the bottom of his jersey, like right, like
who?
Inside his belt. Archer. Yeah.
Yeah.
The Reds announcer was the one that pointed it out.
Oh,
but
the announcers are always the one that pointed it out.
Yeah. But my thing is,
how the hell do they see it?
Throughout the course of a game, it was, it ended up, like, it looked like he had it tucked in, but it ended up being, like, above his belt.
No, I mean, like, so how does an announcer see it up in the booth?
The,
are they just
looking
at a screen?
Yeah, I mean, he's probably looking at a screen or something.
Tyler, it's an old white man. He's going to notice when you're cheating.
But anyway, my whole thing with that was, like, well, obviously
nothing's his wife.
Nothing's going to be done now. I mean, they would have had to caught him yesterday doing it. But also, how was this announcer in the Reds booth the only one to see this, if it, that's what it actually
Yeah, and a lot of times,
like,
they'll be the one to catch it. They'll report it,
that's
and
what
they'll eventually get down to the field.
If that was the case, I feel like that's getting relayed down there.
Who
I
cares?
Just feel like through
let
six
use,
innings.
Let people use steroids. Let people use pine tar.
Let's
make the sport goofy.
That's funny because Tom Brenneman, their other announcer, actually was like, when that got brought up, said, well, to be honest with you, I feel like pitchers should be able to use pine tar
anyway.
They
absolutely should. They absolutely should because...
I mean, that's a different topic because they can't. So if he was, then something should have been done.
Yeah.
But
I completely agree with him on that because in the bullpen, they even tell you, they use a mix of resin and sunscreen, which is basically the same as pine tar.
Mm.
It makes the same feel. And you could probably use that during a game. Because it's clear. You can't see it.
Hmm.
So, the
so
other
very
thing,
well might be already.
Yes. So, the other thing with the pine tar is a lot of hitters say they prefer when pitchers do that. Because they can see the ball better and they can hit the ball harder.
Hmm.
And the pitchers can that hit their spots more proper. But, yeah. No, I completely agree that it should be legal and it shouldn't matter. And if you think using pine tar is cheating, you are wrong.
Coward.
No. How long does someone get suspended if they're caught using pine tar?
It depends.
Well, what was Pineda suspended for when he got caught with the Yankees? 25?
If that.
Hmm.
Yeah, if that.
Yeah, I'm not fully sure. For some reason, I had 25 in my head, but.
I'm like looking at pictures and stuff and videos.
Yeah, I don't care.
All right, well, that about wraps up the baseball talk for this week.
Now the important one.
Next time we talk to you, the Pirates will have at least one more loss than they currently do in their standings.
Oh, no.
What a game to miss, though, because of this. Like,
yeah.
We're missing the game because of doing this, and it's like, at least it's this game.
Yeah, exactly.
Amanda just pointed out Birdie just struck out the side in order. So that's a positive.
Okay.
Yeah, like.
We're going back to baseball for a second.
Birdie.
Also, hi, friends. Hi.
Birdie has been overall good.
Good.
Yeah. There's a couple times where, like, the opening day where nobody was really good in those last few innings.
Yeah.
What other game did he give up a run in?
It was,
was
I
it the game
Thursday? Or no.
Was it the game right after?
Wednesday or Thursday, something like that.
Yeah, so the opener and then the Wednesday game against Cardinals,
yeah.
Both games. Yeah. So the only runs he's given up this year have been to the Cardinals. He's clean slate against the Reds.
He's such an interesting, like, case to me because he'll come in. Load the bases, get two outs, and somebody else will come in and give the runs. It's just weird.
Yeah. I feel like he's already, like, building up a trust level, though.
Oh, absolutely.
Like, he's already been put into higher leverage situations,
mm-hmm.
which typically, like, you wouldn't see. I thought that wouldn't be until, like, June-ish, where, like, that confidence would be in him.
I thought he would have had the confidence, or they would have had the confidence in him just because of all of last season being suspended. Well, not all of last season, but half of last season being suspended. Was that opening day where Rich Rod came in and I was screaming, put in Birdie? I think it was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think so.
I still stand by that was the right answer.
I mean, maybe.
It was opening day.
Yeah, it was definitely opening day because we were all there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, we haven't been to a game yet.
But, I mean, maybe it's... I mean, you said it at the time, so obviously it's not you.
Yeah.
Like, going back in hindsight. But it's hindsight whether it would have worked or not. I mean, yeah,
exactly.
That's
just you. The move I would have made compared to what Hurdle actually did.
Yeah.
Then again, I also am the person that complained, what was that? Saturday? Yeah, Saturday when he put in Frankie in the 10th.
Mm.
That was, oh, I was hyperventilating for a minute.
Yeah, I tweeted congrats to the Reds.
Yeah.
But, okay, yep, Nick Birdy. I mean, with Crick on the DL, we'll see what his exact role is. IL.
Yeah.
Saturday when I got called out on Twitter a lot for saying we have to score 4 runs to win this game, GG, see you tomorrow.
Yeah. Aged like milk.
Hey, in my defense, the 2 games prior they did not show runs. That they were going to score 4 runs.
Okay. Anyway.
Yeah. All right. So, NHL.
Hockey.
It's that Malkin time of Letang year. Came back.
Yeah.
Dumoulin's
arm might be back.
It doesn't seem like we should be talking about this on this episode, but it has been a while since we recorded. 2 extra days tacked on. So, Malkin and Letang are back. A lot of people are skeptical that should even be have been the case.
Yeah.
Like, people thought that their playing hurt very well could be. I mean.
Absolutely.
But we right now don't have Brian Dumoulin or Zach Aston Reese, who could both possibly play in their first game on Wednesday. We'll see where that is at.
Oh, you're telling
me. Zach Aston Reese said it's been a very frustrating season as far as the injuries go, but he's at least been able to work on his skating because it hasn't been lower body.
Yeah. So you're telling me.
He's been hurt like 3 times.
Yeah. You're telling me. All of the Penguins injured players are coming back for the most important time of the year.
Yeah, I didn't see anything about Ruedel, but yeah.
Well,
I mean, unless there's 2 injuries.
At this point, he's not going to crack the lineup ever again.
Probably not. I mean, if he does.
We lose 3 defensemen on Wednesday.
Oh, yeah, God. If he does, then that means something
went
wrong.
Do not speak that evil.
I'm not you, so it won't happen.
Okay, it's happening now.
So, Dumoulin comes back. What happens?
Letang, Dumoulin, Schultz, Johnson, get Branson Pettersson.
Yeah, Mata gets the boot.
Yeah, you have to.
Now, is that what you actually think is going to happen?
Yeah.
Because that's what I'm asking.
That's what I
to
think
me,
is going to happen.
I thought they would take Pettersson out for Mata, but I think they're going to keep him in.
Whose line was Mata on this last game?
He was with Letang, yeah.
Yeah, they're taking him out. If he was playing with Schultz, I'd say they'd take Johnson out, and I'd rather have them take Johnson out. But
I'm honestly not even questioning Johnson. I guess I'm asking Mata or Pettersson.
It has to be Pettersson. He's been too good. He's had bad games, but overall, he's been too good to take out of the lineup.
Yeah, and overall, Gabranson and him have been pretty
good
together.
Yeah.
So, I'm not going to change it.
So what has changed, though, where you said, not necessarily what you wanted, because you've wanted Pettersson, but thought, what has changed that now you think it's going to be Pettersson staying in?
Just the fact that how they've treated Mata since he came back. If they put him on anyone else's line other than Letang, I think he'd stay in the lineup. It's just the fact that they've put him in a spot where it's kind of like, if Dumoulin...
He comes out and Dumoulin comes in.
Yeah, if Dumoulin is partnered with someone when Letang's out, that person's coming out of the lineup. If Letang's partnered with someone that isn't Brian Dumoulin, while Dumoulin's out, more than likely they're coming out of the lineup.
Yeah, so, I mean, since they both got hurt in that stadium series, they really haven't been
together.
Back on the ice together. So, yeah, like you said, they've been treating that as whichever one's missing.
The replacement.
The replacement plays with the other guy.
Yeah.
So, I mean, from that point, that definitely makes sense. I don't know. I guess I'm going to have to see it happen before I believe that it's going to be...
Oh, yeah. Model
the guy
completely
out.
Understand that, yeah. Because that's a lot of money to just not play.
Right,
but
and that's
again,
why we think that they wouldn't scratch
Johnson
is because of the money thing. Well, Mata makes more money.
I
but as far as, like you said, deployment, I mean, he's playing on that right now technically rotating pairing because the 2 guys haven't been healthy. So
I want to ask a question that's probably going to trigger some people.
Oh, God.
Do you think there's even a potential they get rid of Johnson in the offseason?
No.
This offseason, no.
Okay.
I want to look at something.
I didn't know if it'd be like a, hey, take our trash.
I think there's a chance they could get rid of Mata.
Oh, so absolutely. What do you think they get back? Why are we talking about this?
Pick.
That's it?
Pick prospect.
Yeah.
Not going to get an NHL player, I don't think.
Time on Ice in their season finale.
Mm-hmm.
Chris Letang played 28 minutes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Jesus. Hey, it's your first game back. Play half the game.
Pettersson played 16-24. Schultz played 21-23.
Pens aren't losing a game the whole playoffs.
Mata played 18.5.
Who said that?
Ryan.
Johnson played 16-20. So
how much did Mata play?
Yeah, 18.
Oh, wow.
18.5.
But that's significantly less than Letang.
Right.
Yeah, Mata's coming out.
But even, okay, so let me look at something here.
And is Mata on the second power play?
The game before that, Chris Letang 25, Mata 21. Gudbranson 16, Pettersson 16, Johnson 16.5, Schultz 17.
I just don't think you can make a case for taking anyone else out of the lineup right now. The only person you can make a case against is Jack Johnson. They're not going to do that. Because as much as I hate saying it, Eric Gudbranson has not been that bad.
I could understand why somebody would say, you know, he's only having that much time on the ice because he's playing with Letang in the first pairing.
Yeah.
And that makes sense. However, when Trotman was in with Dumoulin, Trotman was only playing 14.
Trotman's also ass.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
Trotman is not an NHL defenseman.
But I guess my only point there is that it's not necessarily just been Mata playing those higher minutes than the other guys because he's playing with Letang.
Yeah. Also, where did the Mata hate begin this season?
This season?
Yeah.
It began in like 2015.
But why?
People have hated Mata for years because he's been slow and he gets burned a lot.
His rookie season, he actually looked like he was going to be an offensive contributor, like that type of defenseman, two-way defenseman. He obviously went through some stuff.
Huh.
The mumps.
Off the ice.
And other things.
Yeah. And isn't technically that player.
Yeah.
But, I mean, he can still contribute a little bit in the offensive zone.
Oh,
but
yeah. And he's still not bad defensively.
Yeah.
I don't think he's bad defensively. I think positionally he can be really good. I just think his downfall, what gets exploited the most and people complain about the most is his speed.
Oh, yeah.
Like, he gets burned more than most.
Well,
which is also why I think it's better to keep Pettersson with Gudbranson, because you don't want Mata getting burned.
Yeah.
Well, Pettersson, he's been getting burned a couple times.
He's started playing a little differently with Gudbranson.
Yeah.
He started playing more pinching is the way I'll put it.
Which doesn't make sense to me. Yeah. Because, I mean, Gudbranson's the faster, I guess, of the two. He's the better skater. Like, you would think that Pettersson's the guy watching his back. Like, I'm going to be the guy back.
I think Pettersson has a better offensive game, but
he might. I mean, he's what, like, third among rookie defensemen in points,
yeah,
which most people didn't even realize. I didn't realize until
it
got brought up.
Points as Daniel Sprong.
Like,
really?
Since they were traded, they've got the same amount of points.
Sprong isn't good.
I mean, he's been a healthy scratch.
Yeah. He's not good.
For a while there, too. He actually had a, like, pretty decent month of March. He had, like, a stretch where he scored, like, 6 goals in 8 games or something. But, anyway, back to Pettersson. Overall, I like him. Like, he has gotten beat a couple times, burned a couple times. If it was my decision, I probably am sitting Mata originally and going from there, like, until a guy, maybe Pettersson
shows
is the first one to slip up. Yeah. Like I said before, these situations tend to have a way of playing themselves out.
Yeah.
So, not all 6 guys are going to be playing at the top of their game. If they are, that's great. Because you don't have a decision to make then. But
it'll be,
it'll play itself out.
Yeah.
It'll play itself out. That's my point.
Who comes out whenever Czar's back?
Garrett Wilson.
Yeah.
You cannot take Teddy Bluger out again.
All right.
You can't.
Nick and I, New Hampshire boy, and I will riot.
Where did that even come from? Like, why the Teddy Bluger hive?
For us too?
Yeah.
I don't know. I liked Teddy Bluger. and I guess he did too. So we're like original stands.
Oh God! Never
so we just hype him up.
I mean, to be honest with you, I'm not mad that he hasn't scored in a while because I haven't had to see that on Twitter. One of those exchanges.
Yeah. Oh, there was one today.
Yeah, there was one today.
Why?
Because he said whenever Bluger scores his first goal of the or his first playoff goal on Wednesday,
yeah.
And then I took it a little step further and said whenever he scores the first goal of the playoffs.
How many? Okay, let me see something.
I am so like. This is gonna
also
he plays 6.5 minutes a night.
Teddy Bluger's from Riga, Latvia. That Steve Dangle clip's funny.
I don't know how that's not an American name.
Teddy Bluger.
Teddy Bluger. How is that not American?
I don't know.
Yeah, I think it will be Garrett Wilson, to be honest, but
he's not bad.
No. He's your run-of-the-mill, what you want of a fourth liner.
Yeah. Honestly, if you had asked me 2 years ago when he first was on the team, I would not have expected him to be anywhere near decent and also not on the team 2 years from then.
Yeah.
So.
All right, so we want to do playoff predictions.
Yeah.
So we're going to
go pull that up.
Just the first round, but also we're going to update our Stanley Cup final each time because very well. That will have to change.
I think mine is going to change a couple times.
So, okay. I guess I can start.
Okay.
I'll give you guys time to look at it. So, Tampa Bay playing Columbus in the first round.
Yes. It's easy.
I think so. I think it's going to be a lot more physical than Tampa Bay would wish from a first-round matchup.
Oh, yeah.
But I think it goes 5. I think Columbus gets one game in Columbus. Where Bobrovsky actually plays like the Sergei Bobrovsky that isn't in the playoffs and actually has a really good game. I think he steals one for them. But I think Tampa wins the other 4 and it only lasts 5.
Agreed. 100% agreed.
So do we want to do it like that? I'll just say the matchup and you guys tell me.
Yeah, I mean, if you want to.
Sure, that's typically okay. How we do things.
All right, so Boston and Toronto.
Did you?
Tampa.
Okay.
Don't even need to ask.
Boston and Toronto play each other. Toronto fans, their petition didn't work. they're playing Boston. This
is interesting. Like, it's interesting enough.
I'm going to say Boston wins in 6, which means them winning, clinching in Toronto, and it's going to be a heartbreaker. I think Toronto's going to have the lead late. Boston ties it, goes to overtime, and Boston wins.
You just won 2013.
Lol.
But it's 6, not 7.
Yeah. At Steve, lol.
Clip it. I want to be Toronto in 7.
I want Toronto to win that series, for the record. Boston.
I think whoever.
I'd want Toronto to win, too.
I'm going
to
give it away now. Whoever wins that series, I think, is going to beat the Lightning.
Okay, so that's.
Now I don't know about that one,
Well,
Chief.
They don't have to listen the.
Next week.
Well, not next week, but the following week, probably.
Yeah. Yeah, Toronto at 7 for me.
I'm picking Boston. I just don't.
In
6.
Okay, I was about to say, if you say 5.
Caps and Canes. I actually really liked this first round matchup.
Yeah.
I think the Hurricanes are very fast. I think that the Capitals.
Defense is not? Yeah, agreed.
Yeah, isn't fast. I don't know how they're going to keep up with them. I think Braden Holtby needs to be fantastic for the Capitals to win that series. I think he's going to be fantastic. I ultimately think that the Capitals win that series, but I think it goes 7.
I think the Canes win in 6.
I said Caps in 6. So,
we need to stick with it.
Somebody, like, write this down.
I will absolutely love it if the Hurricanes win that series.
Oh, okay. I think this is going to be, like, the one, like, feel-good thing like the Knights were last year. Like, it's just going to be,
they kind of have, like, that same feel. Like, all those videos of when they clinched, I mean, it felt like it was the first time that they've clinched.
It's like it looked like they never actually won a Stanley Cup.
Yeah, it looked like they'd never been to the playoffs.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, they won one 13 years ago.
I can't believe it was that long ago, first off.
That is crazy.
I can't believe Cam Ward has been in the NHL for 13 years.
And then, of course, us and the Islanders. The one series where the technical underdog is probably actually going to be the betting odds favorite.
Yeah.
I... I don't know. The Islanders, to me, are, like, this is finally when they are going to show that who they are. Like,
you think?
I mean, I love, I don't love Barry Trotz. I think he's a fantastic coach, though.
Oh, yeah.
I love Barry Trotz.
I would love Barry Trotz as a coach if we had not had Mike Sullivan.
Yeah.
But I like Barry Trotz as a coach a lot. I like a lot of that team. I'm still not sold on Robin Lehner.
Neither am I.
And I think in this series
and
is where
Thomas Grace
is where that shows. Yeah, I mean,
yeah. Which one are they going to play?
We might see both goaltenders in the series.
Oh, you will. You absolutely will.
Yeah, because one's going to get pulled.
But I like the Pens in this series. I want to say five.
So
because I want to see them clinch in Pittsburgh, or I'm sorry, no, Game 6 will be in Pittsburgh.
Yeah,
yeah, that works then. Sorry.
So I
forgot that we didn't have the home ice.
I have a couple things that go into this. I think it's Pens in six for a couple reasons. One, for the sake of our show. Because Game 6 is next Saturday.
Mm.
Right? Or the 20th, sorry.
20th, whenever the 20th is.
The 20th, 2 weeks.
I won't be here.
Right.
Where are you going?
San Diego.
Okay, don't complain.
I'm not complaining. I'm
not going to be here.
I will not be here. Don't complain. You're right. I'm complaining that I'll be in San Diego and not your room.
And Sidney Crosby owns the Islanders.
Yeah.
He has the most points against them than anybody in his career.
I think
so. It's either them or the Flyers.
I think it's the Islanders.
Right. So, I mean, to me, I'm very thankful that the Pens were able to pull out that point.
Oh,
they're almost blowing against the Rangers because I think this is a much better matchup for them in the first round than the Capitals would have been.
I don't trust anything the Islanders are.
Yeah. I mean, that's what I mean. Like, I just don't get how that goaltending has held up all year. I think that they're bound to come back down to earth, and this is where it happens here in the playoffs.
Agreed. And they started to come back down to earth towards the end of the season.
I mean,
I'm
Tom Kuhnhauer was on their second
pens
line.
And five.
What?
Yeah.
Wow. Pens and five.
Pens and five.
Yeah, I had.
They're going to beat them in Long Island. Fuck you're on Island.
I even said, like, I even
did you see their tweet?
Yeah.
I obviously knew Long the Island. Islanders had home ice, but in my head I was like, Game 5 is in Pittsburgh, and I'm like, wait a minute, no, my six works.
That's not how that
yeah,
works.
Yeah, no, I'm saying five. I don't think they're going to hold up.
Yeah.
I don't think enough of that team has playoff experience, and the Penguins will grind them down and beat them in five games.
Okay, so out west, Nashville-Dallas.
Ooh.
I like Nashville.
Nashville.
In the series.
Yeah.
I mean, I like Dallas as a team more. Nashville has more experience. To me, they just
Nashville has
the better
goalie. Better
team. Yeah, I mean, Ben Bishop did have a really good year, but once again, yeah.
You know,
is it
both goalies, you never know.
Is it? Yeah, that's true. I mean, they both might be the worst of the two goalies when they're on the road, so it could just come down to, well, Game 7 is in Nashville,
yeah.
So that's where the game where
I was going to say, I think Preds in 7.
I like the Predators in the series. As far as putting a number on it, I'll say 6 and in Dallas.
Fair enough.
I think in my bracket I said Nashville in 6. So, yeah, Nashville 6.
The most competitive series, I guess you could say, in terms of points in the regular season, Winnipeg and St. Louis playing each
That's
other.
That's going to be interesting.
Yeah.
Patrick Laine did
Winnipeg
not have a good
does
season.
Have the home ice
yeah.
advantage. I don't know. I think that this might be the start of the real Connor Hellebuck breakout, and I think that the Jets take this series.
You have to hope Laine breaks out too. He
yeah.
had that godly stretch and then nothing.
He had 18 yeah. goals in November.
Yeah.
And then he had like 0 in December.
Yeah, and pretty much kept that pace for the rest of the season.
I just think top to bottom they're too talented. I think they were my pick to go to the Cup from the West.
But that's what we were saying about the Blues at the beginning of the season.
Yeah. But I mean the Jets are the team that I just thought was the most talented in the West, so I got to take them. I got to stick with them. I think it takes them all 7 to do it, though.
Blues in 6.
Winnipeg in 7.
Okay. Calgary, Colorado.
Oh, man. Can't just be Calgary so I don't have to deal with Broussard?
I think it is Calgary just because I think Colorado is one line. That's it.
Yeah.
You stop the one line, you win. You beat the team.
So that's two bets you and I have had that have came down to like the last week of the season that
and have gone my way.
Yeah. Damn it.
But yeah, I think I think Calgary beats Colorado in five games. Unless four.
Yeah.
Yeah, see, I think that line takes over for at least one game. Yeah. And that's why I'll say Calgary in five.
Yeah, that's like you would need that line to win you one game. I just don't see them winning a series. Yeah. They don't have the goaltending to win a series. Like, your goaltender might be able to steal one, but one line can't steal one.
Is Varlamov their actual number one? Like, is that a guarantee that he's their goaltender? Or
I don't know.
I think.
Or, like, I don't is think Bernier the...
Ooh.
Either way, whether it comes to Bernier, Varlamov, or Grubauer, it's... like
Grubauer.
Still.
You don't have a good enough goalie to steal you a series.
Or defense.
Varlamov,
Tyson Barrie is your best.
Varlamov
defenseman?
Started 49 games. Grubauer started 33. So
it's probably gonna be Varlamov. Probably.
Yeah. Calgary in five. I'll say Colorado wins.
Grubauer's
one of the home
Grubauer's
games.
Numbers are better across the board. What the heck?
Well, yeah. There was a period of time where I said he would be the face of the Capitals if they moved on from Holpe.
Yeah. I just don't understand why Varlamov's gotten the bulk of the work here.
Because it's Semyon Varlamov.
Colorado won 7-1-2 in their last 10, though, to get into the playoffs.
Damn.
Yeah. I think
two of those were against the Coyotes. Mm. So.
Yeah. And then the last first-round matchup, San Jose and Vegas.
Nice and six. I do also agree that I have the Knights winning. I don't remember if I said six or seven games. But it was one of the later two. Six or seven.
I know that the Sharks, just played in a cup recently. Word to the Penguins. But they're not a team that I can get behind in the playoffs. There's just something about them. I can't pick them.
Yeah.
I'm going with the Knights in six.
Also, have you seen their schedule, like the last part of their schedule that they played? Like their wins and losses?
Mm-mm.
Let me pull it up real quick.
They came in slumping, huh?
I mean, they didn't have Erik Karlsson. So, but they do have him now, I think.
But that's the thing. He's still not there, and I don't think. Like, you're not going to have the Erik Karlsson.
Since March 14th, loss, 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 win, loss, win, win.
How did they make the playoffs?
Yeah.
I guess they were so far ahead.
Yeah.
And the Pacific was so bad.
But, I mean, yeah, who was the team behind them?
But they lost, six in a row or seven in a row. Six in a row, seven in a row.
That's a good question. I don't know who was.
I mean, they still had 101. Yeah, the Knights were 8 points behind them for second in that division.
Who was the first team out in the Pacific?
In the Pacific?
Yeah.
Arizona.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. By 7 points.
Feels bad, man.
So, did Edmonton not finish at the bottom?
No.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah, they finished second to last.
They did finish behind the Ducks and Canucks.
Ottawa finished last, so congrats Colorado on getting Jack Hughes.
Pretty much. Pretty much.
You'll win a playoff series next year.
How much are you going to bet the Oilers are going to win the lottery?
Let's see the Coyotes.
If McDavid broke his leg, then yes. But
I want
he
the
didn't,
Coyotes
so.
To win it.
I think the Oilanders, Jesus.
The Oilanders.
Give me the Panthers. Give me the Panthers winning it with their new coach,
Joel Quenneville.
Yeah. What a hire. Their Twitter account has not shut up today about that.
I know.
They posted every player's quote about it.
Oh, yeah.
They had 50 tweets in an hour. It was insane.
That's like you go to Twitter jail? That's like you doing a sporting event.
I don't know how they, I don't know how they didn't get put in Twitter jail.
Rip.
But, okay, so.
Cup winner?
Don't want to go any further as far as bracketing that off. But, yeah, who you putting in the cup and winning it right now.
I guess I'll just put who I put in my bracket.
Mm-hmm.
I did choose with my heart over mind. Penguins in Calgary and the Penguins winning.
In
six games.
Blues and Leafs. Leafs in seven.
I'm doing Pens Jets.
Oh, again.
Yeah. And the Jets
next year, Smitty. Pens Jets.
The Jets missed.
Jets would have home ice, so Pens in six.
Oh,
well, you're saying they went at home for finally.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I want to pick they win in five or seven. Because they're just they feel like they're always going to win on the road.
Because they will never win at home.
Which okay, I don't. Speaking of which I also wanted to bring up NHL awards too. But while we're talking about home and away,
yeah.
So my friend Ryan, you know Ryan. You've never met Ryan. So he had tickets, or his family has season, or his dad had season tickets, but his dad passed away, so his brother had them. Yeah, not to get morbid real quick, but basically they had tickets, and he would have had tickets to game 7 if the Cup in 17 had gone to 7.
Ooh.
And so he wanted the Penguins to lose game 6 so he could go to game 7.
Well, that had to have
been
to
me,
that's a fine line, but I'm not taking that chance.
Yeah.
I am under the impression you win it as quick as possible.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't absolutely care what ticket I have, what chance I have to go to the game. Win the cup. Win the thing.
But
I don't care.
But there's something special about being at a Stanley Cup Game 7.
Yeah, there's something special about winning it, too.
Well, yeah.
They lose it. I don't care.
Yeah, and then it goes to 7, and you lose, and you're there for it.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh.
Yeah.
Like imagine having complete control of your situation. Obviously, that's not the case.
Yeah.
But basically saying, I don't want them to win this game, so they're going to lose, mm-hmm, so that they can play a game 7.
And they're going
to
win.
And then I don't know what's going to happen. No, and then I don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah. So just like thinking about that, if I was in that situation and I had that same mindset, that'd be such a weird thing when they want to be like, damn it, yes!
Yeah. I'm going.
Like, I couldn't do that. To me, home or away, sweep every cup if you can.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
But I'm not risking losing a game 7.
I mean, I can get that mindset of wanting to be there.
Oh, I completely get, like, wanting to be there. But the risk you're, like, wanting to your team to lose when they have the opportunity to win it. It's not like they lose and it just extends the series to, like, another game where, like, then you can win it. It's like they could win it that night, and he wanted them to lose.
Now, I could see, say they're up 3-0, and you have the chance to sweep, but you have tickets to game 5 of the cup final.
I thought you were going to say game 7 again.
I guess I can see that, but the thing with game 7.
Yeah.
That's...
No. I mean, and even then, I'm thinking, like, nah, because it gets them back into the series. Like,
so, like, that's actually, now that I think about that, that's probably, like, a bucket list thing for me. Even if the Penguins aren't in the cup, go to a game 7, stay in the cup.
Have fun taking a loan.
Yeah.
You better hope a team like the Florida Panthers,
or no one can go to
like, yeah. Fun fact, I was going to, so whenever the Penguins were in the cup against Nashville, during game 4, if
contemplating going.
Well, no, so during game 4, if the Penguins, I wanted to go to game 5,
because
the Penguins would have had a chance to win on home ice if they had won game 4. So I said in my mind, if the Penguins are up after the second period, I'm going to buy a ticket to game 5. And they were tied after the second period, so I didn't end up buying the ticket to game 5, which they ended up losing anyway.
Yeah.
But I would have, yeah. Or no, they won, but they didn't. They won game 5, but they couldn't have won the cup. So I remember the tickets, like, the ticket prices whenever they could have had the chance to win on home ice, like when the game was still tied, were like around $1,000, like the cheapest ticket. And then they just, like, plummeted to, like, the cheapest ticket was like $400 for game 5.
I was gonna say, it's so funny to watch pricings of tickets go up and down.
Yeah, which, I mean, if the Pens are in the cup this year, I'll probably do the same thing. Like, if they have the chance to win it for a certain game at home, and sometime during the game, if they're winning, like, after the second period, I'm going to buy a ticket.
I'm still triggered the Penguins invited somebody to go to a playoff game, and I've still never been. Worth.
And the reason I would buy it during the game, because as soon as the Penguins win that game, and it's guaranteed they have a chance to win it at home, prices skyrocket.
Yeah.
But, yeah. So, NHL awards.
Dumb.
Kucherov won the Art Ross.
Oh, yeah.
And, 128 points?
God. Yeah.
Which Tampa Bay had 128 points on the season.
Yeah.
And good God.
21 more than the second highest.
Yeah. And Crosby had 100 points, and the Penguins had 100 points.
And Gensel scored
40. And McDavid had 160 points, and the Oilers had 77.
You heard it here first. Penguins Lightning conference finals.
But then what? Ovechkin won another Rocket Richard.
Yeah. But only by one goal.
Yeah.
Really?
Draisaitl scored 50.
Tavares had 47. Stamkos 45. Kane 44.
Kane.
Patrick.
Wow. Yeah. No.
Evander.
Glenn Jacobs.
Alex DeBrink at 41.
Yeah. I'm with Steve on that. I'm still pissed about that.
Along with Atkinson.
Cam Atkinson?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he set like the
Braden
goals per
Point
season.
Had 41.
I think he beat Rick Nash's record.
Holy.
Gensel and Skinner with 40. I'm surprised Skinner only scored 40. I feel like he was like at 34 2 months ago.
That's how bad the Sabres were the rest of the season.
Yeah. But so for MVP, we already kind of talked about this.
Yeah.
Not that, like, I don't put all my stock in points, obviously, because otherwise Kucherov slammed on the MVP.
Oh, yeah.
But Johnny Gaudreau ended up being eighth in points after he was, like, hovering around fourth. Yeah. We're like, it's
what
easy
did Crosby
to make
end up being,
case.
Fifth or sixth?
Tied for fifth.
Okay. Who else had 100 points?
Brad Marchand.
Hmm. Wow.
Yeah. So, I don't know. Because Johnny Gaudreau was, like, my guy the entire season that I said MVP. Like, Crosby was already voted best player by the players, so that should be an easy pick right there for the Ted Lindsay. That's already basically been.
I hope he wins the Ted Lindsay.
But as far as MVP, like, for some reason, I just have a way of gravitating towards the guys that play for a team I wasn't necessarily expecting to be there. Like,
yeah.
Exceeded expectations and taking their best player. And to me, that's Johnny Gaudreau this year with the Flames.
Agreed.
But it's tough now because, like I said, he finished eighth in points.
Yeah.
Didn't crack 100. Finished with 99.
Didn't crack 100. One line.
Wait, so technically, no. Because the way that they do this, he technically had the sixth highest point total.
Okay.
Because Kucherov, McDavid, Kane, Draisaitl, Marchand, Crosby tied, McKinnon, and Gaudreau tied.
Okay.
How about Barkov, 96?
Sasha.
Even Huberto, 92.
Yeah. That's how bad the rest of the team was.
I think the finalists should be Kucherov, Crosby, and Gaudreau. I don't think Kane and I don't think McDavid should be considered.
How
about Brad Marchand? I mean, with the way that he finished the season.
Yeah.
I mean, they get to 100 points.
Yeah.
Boston's the second best team in the East.
Mm-hmm. I don't think Sid's in the conversation.
I think he is. I think Sid will end up at least third in voting, if not second, if not winning it.
Thing there, Marchand and Gaudreau aren't centers.
Yeah.
Which, I don't know if that plays into it. To me, it does a little bit because he's more defensive responsibility.
Yeah.
He's very good at that defensive responsibility.
And he could win the Selkie, so.
He could.
So, I mean, whether or not he will be a finalist, I don't know. But I would have the same finalists as you with Kucherov, Crosby, Gaudreau.
And also, if you, like, the MVP is not, like, the definition is not MVP of the league. It's MVP,
the team.
Most valuable player on your team, like, of the team.
Yeah.
So, if you take, like, say, for people saying Kucherov, just because he scored 128 points, if you take him off of Tampa Bay, how much worse are they?
Yeah. They still have a guy with 98 points, 92 points. Same defense, obviously. And, I mean, I don't know how great of a year Vasilevsky had. I think he was kind of up and down.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah, like, if you take him off, they finished, what, you said 21 points ahead of the next team?
Yeah.
Like, how, I still think they finished first. I don't think they're going to fall 21 points back.
That's crazy, though. 87 assists. Like, he had more assists than most guys had points.
Yeah.
If he didn't score a goal this season, he'd be tied for, hold on, 1, 2, 3.
Math. Brought to you by
like
Hot Tub Network.
11th? 12th?
He would have the, no, 12. He'd have the 14th most points in the NHL without a goal.
Yeah. I mean, well, that's, not to bring up Gretzky, but like it's like if Gretzky never scored a goal, he'd still have more points than everybody else in the league.
Yeah.
Ever. But, yeah, and to me, Crosby is more valuable to his team than anyone else is.
I mean, especially
because
this year.
If he didn't play the way he did, we're not we, like we. There was a serious chance we weren't making playoffs.
Oh, absolutely.
The month of February, like the end of January to the beginning of March, he literally willed the Penguins into a playoff spot.
The fact that I believe in February, I said the Penguins are going to miss the playoffs, and it took them to the second last game to clinch and almost fell into a wild card. That's scary.
Look at, to me, the turning point was that Stadium Series loss. I think that is when really Crosby turned it on.
Yeah.
Crosby and Gensel together willed the team to a playoff spot.
Yeah. They willed them from not being a wild
card. This is the year you needed. Yeah. This is the year you needed Crosby more than any other. I mean, you need him every year. But with the injuries to Malkin, Letang being out multiple times,
mm-hmm. Kessel having a down. He had 82 points, but it's still down year.
The goal
still.
Scoring was down.
Yeah, yeah. It's still crazy. He had a point per game, though.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was still like fifth in power play points.
He's so good. That deal is such a steal.
But to me, that's why I think Crosby has a serious chance of winning it, because he's most valuable to his team over any player, I think, this year.
Probably.
I think that they have to take a look into the factors that don't even necessarily affect him, like I said, with the injuries to other key players on the team. Like, the fact that they had 100 points, even with Malkin and Letang missing significant time. I mean, you could even say, Murray started 50 games this year, but he also played way more games down the stretch than you would have liked, probably, mm-hmm. because he had to.
Yeah.
But he had points in time where he was hurt and also not that great.
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
Sid literally willed the team to a playoff spot.
I will.
So.
And a somewhat rotating other winger besides Gensel.
Yeah.
Rust, Simone, McCann, Hornquist, they've all played the other wing on that first line this year.
Okay. Yeah, I think, and not that it should matter, but it does. I think it's the same reason that Kessel didn't win the Conn Smythe in 2016 and Sid did. Not that Sid didn't deserve it, obviously he did, but Kucherov is not Canadian. And I think hockey writers
are biased
to Canadians.
I would have loved to seen Phil win that, though. Crosby definitely deserved it. Like, getting back to the fact that he plays a more premium position.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But
that's where it's like Kessel had more points, but points aren't everything.
Yeah.
Okay. So we should probably wrap up. We're going on 2 hours. Mm-hmm. But I do want to say two things, really. So Chris Davis. Crush Davis.
Oh, God.
Not
Oilers Chris Davis?
Yeah.
No. Not Oilers.
Orioles.
Has
I believe now passed the longest hitless streak in the MLB ever.
Is he like over 35?
0 for 40-something.
0 for 40-something going back to last year. Yeah. 0 for whatever this year.
Yeah, the streak was 0 for 46, and he was 0 for 44 last night. How bad do you have to be at baseball to still make $161 million over your contract, and you're going to get paid it?
He's the luckiest guy in the world right now.
Pretty much. Also, I don't remember what site
it was
on.
He's looking at them like, cut me, please.
Yeah. I also don't remember what site it was on, but I think it was Alex Stumpf that tweeted it out because somebody asked who would win in a race, Colin Moran or Matt Kemp.
Mm.
Newsflash, Matt Kemp. But I also decided, hey, let's do the race between Josh Bell, Chris Davis, Matt Kemp, and Colin Moran. You want to know who wins?
Bell.
Chris Davis.
What?
By like a hair.
How?
I don't know.
Did you see Bell second? Did you see Bell go first at home on that?
I know. Yeah.
On that double, I think it was Gong that hit the double. Yeah.
Wheeling it.
Okay. Cervelli going first to home or what? Second home, first to
first
home,
first
to home
on that Newman.
Yeah.
Double. Yeah.
That like Cervelli has a like.
He has a.
He's fast for a catcher.
Yeah.
Fast for a catcher, but like I think it's just his strides, like the way he runs.
He runs like
makes
an
it look a lot slow. I would say, like the way he runs, you know he's Italian. He runs like with like this like elegance, like the beauty about him.
His legs kind of go off to the side a little bit,
and he has like this little. It's like a.
It's like a trot.
I was gonna say it's like a trot, especially whenever he like gets out at first. You see him like bounce when he's like rounding first to go back to the dugout.
Okay.
All right. The things we notice.
Well, everybody, if you're still watching, thanks for watching. If you're watching and not following, please hit that follow button. If you're feeling generous, you might realize there's a little subscribe button if you want to hit that. If you have an Amazon Prime or anybody you know has an Amazon Prime, you can link that to your Twitch account. You get one free subscription per month. Does not auto-renew, so you have to come here and renew it every single month, which I actually have to do still. Follow us on Twitter, follow us on Instagram, go follow everything on the Podhub Network and listen to all them. All great shows. Talk to you next week. Hat down, cross town, living like a rock star. Spend a lot of money on my brand new guitar.